effect of climate and also severe temperature, that are low or even high in summer now. And then you find that China is now using this technology over 2 million hectare area. And in India, we did annual assessment only last year through a national seminar on protected cultivation. We found that our area is only 40,000 hectares. Where we and where China? And under these protected cultivation, you can increase your productivity by 4 to 5-fold. And you can raise income of the farmers. Which means apple cultivation is shifting upward, higher altitude. And the lower altitude is now no more suitable. So this is the impact of climate. So what do we do? Either look for good varieties which can tolerate this high temperature, or think of other crops like kiwi. Now is quite successful in the lower altitude area. When we introduced it in mid-60s, nobody knew the importance of kiwi. But today kiwi has become a good fruit crop. So there will be in future changes in cropping patterns due to the climate change. And we must do the study of it, otherwise we will be left behind. We are, as I told you before, the land use change leads to about 11% of greenhouse gas emission and agriculture about 13, so total about 24%. And out of these, major greenhouse gases are either from wild animals, large animals, buffalo and cattle, and their mismanagement, that's why it is more emission. So we have to bring in better management of this livestock. And then other major emission is from rice crop. So in rice, you have to ensure that methane emission is reduced. And for that, we know that rice is a major source of methane, but there is the potential to reduce this. And how can it be reduced? Just see this experiment done in Japan. But I don't see these kinds of experiments in our situation. See this, mid-season aeration, just by aeration to certain period, 1 week, 2 weeks, maybe. This is the emission when there is continuous flooding. No aeration, but continuous flooding. This is the methane emission. When you have 1 week aeration brought in, then the reduction of methane is this extent. Then when you go for 14 days or 2 weeks, this is the methane emission, quite significantly reduced. And when you go for 3 weeks, practically there is no methane emission. But then, for 3 weeks, then you go in for aeration, and what will be the effect of yield of the rice has to be understood in our situation. And such studies have to be done. For which you need a very competent human resource and the best institutions with ultra modern facilities. So finally, related to climate smart agriculture, we need now climate smart villages, which requires an integrated community-based approach, where you want to have weather smart, water smart, carbon smart, nutrient smart, energy smart, and knowledge smart agriculture. And for that you have, for every one of those, you have options available, weather forecast, direct seeding of crop, or changing cropping pattern, or go for no-till drill, or you can go in for efficient nitrogen use, using vertical seed drill. Vertical seed drill itself can improve the nutrient use by almost 25%. We need also research of this kind relating to this is Monsanto, and the visit by the Science Secretary of Nature, Natasha Gilbert, to their lab last month. This has come in Nature. Publication, and it clearly tells that they are now ready with drought tolerant maize and drought tolerant wheat. And what they are saying, inside the hot houses of industry, which means you don't need now greenhouses, you want hot houses to test this just now. Under high heat, under the stress of drought, And then if still they are performing, and now biotechnology, you might have come to know, you have technologies for gene editing, CRISPR-Cas9 approach, by which you can edit, you can transfer these genes at your will. And there are genes for dog problems, subordinate problems, wheat problems, and whatnot. So finally, my last part is changing paradigm. We need an enabling environment for scaling these innovations. There is need for it now. We need public-private partnership, otherwise research and institutions will not be in the agriculture. We need on-farm participatory approach for natural resource management. My wife is a retired professor of microbiology. She has been working with farmers, promoting use of Trigonium culture and also the other fertilizer, biofertilizer. And when she would work with the farmer, farmer at the end would say, "Madam, I don't see any increase in the yield. Because the Trigonium culture will not give you increase in yield, but would give you additional what you call it nitrogen fixation, 30 to 40 kg. But that benefit you will be able to see only in the next crop. But farmer doesn't have patience up to that level. So extension worker has to work maybe for 2 to 3 years as a long-term initiative, rather than just telling that this is hybrid, this is variety, this gives you 30% yield, farmer will automatically adopt. Under NRF, you have another challenge of working with farmer. And then you cannot simulate all conditions of farmer on your research farm. So you will have to work with the farmer. So farmer's participatory approach becomes very, very important. Capacity, all these issues were discussed before. And then we need policies for scaling innovation. We need to remove difficulties to enforce legal intellectual property rights, like patenting, etc. We have to provide subsidies which are for poor. We must reward researchers. Like I was happy to see that there is an incentive scheme here for good teachers and professors for their better performance, which you don't see in many other institutions. Everywhere we treat everyone on equal platform, because otherwise there will be joint trial. But only those who have this tech have progress. So we need this. We need also enabling environment of our scaling innovation through public-private partnership. So finally, in conclusion, I would say agriculture will certainly liberate us from hunger, malnutrition, and poverty, which are still our concern. And this is the widening income divide between rural and urban population. In fact, in India, we are building 2 India. One poor India and one rich India. And if we don't take care of it, there will be social unrest in the future. It is already happening in many cases. And therefore, this is an issue which is a policy-related issue, social issue, and need to be looked at. Even the declining land, water, and agro-biodiversity resources, besides adverse impact of climate change, the task ahead is very difficult, but certainly not insurmountable. Geoengineering towards integrated farming systems research would ensure farmers' participation, and that is the only way to proceed further. And greater emphasis now is needed for whatever is the innovation available, whether it is GM crops, whether it is new hybrid, whether it is hybrid of sweet corn or baby corn, or whether it is the technology of biofertilizers. They need to be all scaled up. And when we say biofertilizers, use of biofertilizer is important, but how much we are producing? Out of 17 million tons which we produce as NPK, it is not even 3%. And this emphasis we are giving on biofertilizers for last 20 years. So when we will have 10% replacement, by just walking will not happen. You will definitely now need vision mode approach to proceed forward and address these concerns. So we must have foresight, faith in science, which currently policy makers seem to have lost. And therefore, the challenge for science is to convince policy makers that science is the only solution of the problem. Agriculture is considered a part of problem, but agriculture is also a solution for the problem. That has to be understood. And building new partnership, if we did have partnership with International Rice Research Institute and Maize Institute and Wheat Institute in Mexico and Philippines, we would have not gone to our wheat and would have not got this great knowledge. Partnership is very, very important. Today you are building partnership with many institutions abroad. Today only some university from their leader was here to build a joint program. So these kinds of partnership would be very essential. And if we do this, we definitely would have a better future for coming generations. And we could provide you. Now, Indira Gandhi said that do anything but not let your national leader go abroad and beg for food. That was the call which she gave at that time. When she went and then vegan state, they said, if there is no money, no food for India. Today, you can raise your head high that you are self-sufficient in food production. But you cannot raise your head high because still there are poor people who can't get this food. Still, there are children who don't have good nutrition. And you have to diversify this agriculture, which was earlier cereal centric because we needed cereal for our food security. But now you have to diversify to horticulture, fishery, animal, and also horticulture action. So we need to provide this better future for our organization. I hope I have been able to tell you. I come from a village in Rajasthan, which is a desert district with very less natural resources. I started my studies in village sports. My years started in sixth. I was quite poor and years together. Then my mother being illiterate forced me to go for higher education. So when I completed my graduation from the Anand College at Leeds, she said that you must do your MSc. So I looked for institutions and then I landed in Udaipur Agricultural University of Rajasthan. And then when I did that and I got every time certain attractive jobs, even after graduation, after master's, and I was the only son. I had four sisters, but my mother would not let me do service. She said, if you don't study in continuation, you would then later on not be able to complete. So she said, now you go for PhD, and the PhD at that time, there were no agricultural universities. They were just coming up, some struggle and all, in mid-60s market. So 64, only institution was Indian Agriculture Institute, the premier institution. So I applied, somehow I got admitted. Very few used to get from Rajasthan admitted. But I tell you, if I had not come from Rajasthan to Delhi, I would have not known about India. And then when I completed my PhD, my mother still would insist that you must go for still higher studying if there are any. I said, there is no degree. He said, usko hota hoga. So I applied for postdoc fellowship in United Kingdom, and luckily I got it. If I went there, and if I would have not gone to UK, I would have not known what world is, and what India is, and where we stand vis-à-vis the rest of the world. So, I came back, started my research career. Then, only thing what succeeded, I was not poor in studies, I was not very, you know, among first, second or third, but maybe fourth or, but in, when I was in matric, maybe I was fourth in the class, then in graduation I was around second, in master's I got gold medal, then in PhD I got gold medal. So, then I said, nothing going, it is the hard work which pays, and I tell you, all are not intelligent, but the commitment, hard work, and perseverance is the only answer for success. And the only approach you should have, everyone works for himself, but you must think what are you doing for your nation and for others in the society. Don't take, give. It means have broad heart and build it. If you have, and you should go and see the best. I went to Fort Collins and saw the gene bank, which was the best gene bank in America. I came back, I was director of the institute, and the gene bank. I didn't have even a single room to store the seeds. And then when I asked for money from my director general, he said, no money, no land, but you build the gene bank. And I have my full support to you. So I started begging from USAID and from Japan. And then I got at that time in 1985 the project which even US did not get for their own renovation of the gene bank, $25 million at that time. And I built that. So, many of us go abroad, come back, see good lab. I was told many times abroad that Indians, when they come abroad, they do so well, because I also did well. I published in most of the best journals, including Nature. But then, they said that when they go back, they don't, they are not anywhere in the picture. They are not even known. So when I came back, started it, I was fortunately leader of my research team in Haryana University with about 30 scientists. Best thing I did was to build a good team. And my first award was ICR Team Research Award, not individual. So, you must, and whatever you do, don't keep to yourself. It must be known to others. Otherwise, no one will ever appreciate what you are doing. So, we must try to show, or not try to just be, or egoist in that sense, but at least reflecting what you have done, what you have achieved. And then when we bought the gene bank, I assured the director that all human scientists in the institute were trained in US. That was the component besides the gene bank. So that you need human resources, bricks and mortar, don't make the name. Dr. Khosla and you all will make the name of the institution. And then, wherever I went, I had one motive to serve, not to govern. I think that is one motive which you could also keep into your mind if you like it. Otherwise, people enjoy governing others and saying no. And in my corridor, no scientist would be approaching me for their usual, you know, work or for their usual interest, because I had told them, send me a letter, an email, because I was the first to start email in ICR system. I did it after I joined the Director General. For 2 months I did not have my visitor's card printed because there was no email address with the NCR. So imagine from where we have come there. And in that respect, you must build the best facility, best lab. So when I was director and Dr. Borlaug was Nobel Peace Laureate, for food and the only agriculture scientist, when he came to me, when I had just joined, he saw my lab and said that you have a big challenge to innovate them. And the next year he came, I still have written letter from him that perhaps in 1 year I have not seen anywhere a reformation of institution of this kind which I have seen here.
Dear students, you have seen the picture from where this country started, from the famines to the new revolution, and now how we have to work in more precision and scientific manner and using the frontier areas of knowledge so that the manner in which we are growing in population. And we have also shown what will happen in 2016 onwards. Indian government to put science in our agriculture. Very elaborate and comprehensive lecture. I have said God, my days, we also started that we were born in 7 days. I belong to Ludhiana, and then in the urban cities, Rashtra is the government, Lal Gahu Milta Ka, Hellily Jate De. मुझे भैनी थी तो माँ डॉक्टर को भेजती थी हम खुद वेटरनरी में जाकर डॉक्टर बनाते थे दो बार डेज यू आर वेरी लकी यू आर बॉर्न एट अ टाइम व्हेन यू आर ग्रीन रेवोल्यूशन यू हैव अ सरप्लस फूड